Good morning, dear students. Hope all of you are safe at home. So, in science, so far we have discussed about different methods to separate solid substances from a mixture, isn't it? So, we have discussed about different methods like
hand picking, winnowing, and threshing.
So, the next method of separation that we are going to discuss is sieving. S-I-E-V-I-N-G, sieving. So, when the components of a mixture are of different size, the method sieving is used. So, for this method sieving, a sieve can be used to separate the materials. Okay, a sieve, S-I-E-V-E. A sieve can be used to separate those components that are of different size. A sieve is a shallow vessel that have many holes. So, the size of a hole in a sieve is based upon the size of different components. Okay, so that's about the sieve. Sieve is a shallow vessel that contains many holes, and the size of the hole will depends upon the size of the components to be separated. So the method of separating components of a mixture that are of different size with the help of a sieve is called as sieving. Okay, so sieving is the method of separating components of a mixture that are of different size by using a sieve is called as sieving. Okay, and you may have familiarized with the technique of sieving in your home itself. For separating the wheat bran from wheat flour, we are using this sieving technique. Similarly, in the case of construction purpose also, you may have seen that we are using a sieve for separating small pebbles and stones from sand for the construction purpose of buildings and your house itself. So, just have a look into that picture.
Sieving purpose is used for separation of pebbles and stones from sand. Here, larger sieves being used at building construction sites to separate the pebbles and stones.
To understand more about sieving and the technique, we have to conduct an activity that is provided in your textbook. So, we need some materials to conduct this activity. So, the materials required are some amount of wheat flour, and some pulses, colored chalk powder, and a sieve. These are the things that is required for this activity. First, take a 100 gram of wheat powder and add some pulses into it and mix it well. So, we get a mixture. Then, put the mixture on this sieve and the sieve is moved back forth. Similar like this. So, what we can observe? We can observe the wheat flour is moving down through the sieve and the remaining part, that is the pulses, are remaining on the sieve itself. Isn't it? Similarly, mix 100 gram of wheat flour along with the colored chalk powder and mix it well. So, this mixture is put on a sieve and similarly move it back forth. So, what we can observe? We can observe that the wheat flour along with the chalk powder move through the sieve and nothing is remained within the sieve. So, through these two activities, we can conclude that the substance like pulse, what is the reason that is the pulse remained in the sieve? Because the pulse is much higher size than the pores or the holes of the sieve. The pulse contain more size than the holes of the sieve. That's why it is get remained within the sieve. And the wheat flour along with the chalk powder, both these have small size than the size of the sieve. Okay, so we can conclude that the materials can be separated in accordance with their size by using the technique of sieving. Okay, so sieving is applied only when the size of the components of a mixture is different and by using a sieve. Is that clear? Okay, then we are moving on to the next, that is separation of insoluble solids from liquid. Liquid that we are considering here is water. So, separation of insoluble solids from liquids. Liquids here is water. So, in order to separate the solids, insoluble solids from liquids, the solids will be heavier than the liquids. So, we have to do this activity, that is separation of insoluble solids from liquids by sedimentation and decantation. These are the two processes that are used for the separation of insoluble solids from liquids. The two processes like sedimentation and decantation. These are the two processes to separate the insoluble solids from liquids. So, for this we have to conduct an activity. In that activity, we need two beakers, a glass rod, water and a small quantity of sand. Okay, so we are going to separate the mixture of sand and water by using the techniques of sedimentation and decantation. So, just have a look into the activity.
For the activity of observing sedimentation and decantation, add some sand into a beaker of water and stir it with a glass rod. Since the sand is heavier and insoluble in water, it settles down at the bottom. This layer of sand is called sediment. When the sand settles down, clear water remains above the layer of sand. And after some time, pour the clear water into another beaker gently with the help of a glass rod without disturbing the sediment of sand. So, when all the clear water has been poured out, only sand is left at the bottom of the beaker. So, we can conclude that in this way, sand and water can be separated from their mixture. First by sedimentation and then by decantation.
So, the process of settling down the heavier particle at the bottom of the liquid is called as sedimentation. What is sedimentation? Sedimentation is the process of settling down of heavier particle at the bottom of the liquid is called as sedimentation. And the particle which is settled down at the bottom of the liquid is called as sediment. Sediment. And the heavier particle that is settled down at the bottom of the liquid is called as sediment. And this process is called as sedimentation. Similarly, the pouring of the clear liquid from the vessel without disturbing the sediment is just like this. Without disturbing the sediment is called as decantation. What is decantation? The process of pouring out the clear liquid from the vessel without disturbing the sediment is called as decantation. So this technique that we have applied in the case of separation of insoluble solids from liquid. Similarly, the method of decantation can be applied in the case of immiscible liquids also. So when we are taking oil and water, so just mix both. So we can see two different layers. Why? Because the oil is immiscible with water, that is not dissolving in water. So we can separate the oil by decantation, by pouring the clear liquid from the vessel without disturbing the other one. So this similar method of decantation can be applied in the case of two immiscible liquids too. Okay, there is also another process for the separation of insoluble solid from liquid. You just see how we can separate tea leaves from a tea. We are using a tea strainer to separate the tea leaves, which is from the tea. So that process, for that process we are using a tea strainer, and the tea strainer will contain a wire mesh in it, isn't it? So by using this wire mesh, the tea leaves are collected on the wire mesh, which is the tea is passing through the filter, that is through the wire mesh. So this process is called as filtration. So the second process is filtration. Filtration. The first processes are sedimentation and decantation, and the second process is filtration. So for filtration, a filter can be used. A filter.
For understanding more about filtration, take freshly prepared tea, decant it from tea leaves. But while decanting, few leaves still remains in the tea. So we can conclude that we cannot separate all the mixtures by the process of decantation. Then what we'll do is, we can use a tea strainer to separate the tea leaves.
So a filter can be used to separate the tea leaves from tea. So here in that case, a filter is a wire mesh, that is a tea strainer. Okay, is that clear? What is filtration and what is a filter? So filtration is a process of separating insoluble solids from liquids by using a filter. Is that clear? Filtration is the process of separation of insoluble solids from liquids by using a filter. But when we need to separate mud from water, can we use the tea strainer? No, because the holes of the tea strainer are much higher than the mud particles. So we need a filter paper to separate the mud particles from the mixture. So we need a filter paper. What is a filter paper? Filter paper is a piece of special paper that has millions of small tiny holes in it. Okay, that is a filter paper.
To perform an activity, to learn about the process of filtration, take soil and water mixture in a glass beaker. Now take a small piece of cotton cloth. Take another glass beaker and put the cloth on top of it. Now pour the mixture through the cloth. What do you observe? You will observe that soil particles remained in the cloth while the water passes through the cloth and gets collected in the second beaker. Do you know why? This is because cotton cloth acts as a filter. Let us learn how a cotton cloth acts as a filter. In a piece of cloth, small holes or pores are there in between the woven threads. It is actually these small pores that act as a filter. The soil particles are bigger in size than these pores. So they cannot pass through these pores and remain in the cloth. While water molecules, being smaller than the pore size of the cloth, can easily pass through the cloth. Thus, by using a filter, we can separate out components of a mixture.
The holes of a filter paper can't be seen through our naked eye. We can observe the holes of a filter paper only with the help of a microscope. So just have a look into an experiment that is conducted by using a filter paper and what is the purpose of using a filter paper. Okay, so just have a look into that activity.
We have learned that clothes act as a filter. Apart from clothes, a filter paper is another type of filter that has very fine pores in it.
Take a filter paper and make it as a cone and place this filter paper cone in a funnel. Keep an empty beaker below the funnel. Pour the muddy water slowly into the cone using a glass rod. So the clear water passes through the filter paper and collects in the beaker kept below the funnel. The clear liquid obtained is called filtrate. And the mud particles cannot pass through the filter paper and remain behind on the filter paper is called a residue.
The process of filtration is having so much importance in our daily life. We use the technique of filtration in many cases of our daily life. So just have a look into what are the uses of the filtration in our daily life. First, we are using the filters or the strainers for separating the juice, the pulp and seeds from a juice. We are making juice from vegetables and fruits. So while preparing the juice, we are using the filtration technique to separate the pulp and seeds from the juice. Okay, and that is the first use in our daily life. And the second thing is for the preparation of paneer. So while we are preparing paneer, we just adding a small drop, a few drops of lemon juice into water, into boiled milk. So we get the paneer along with the milk. So from this, the paneer is removed from by filtering it or by using filters or strainers. In that, cloth filters are used. So for the preparation of paneer, the technique filtration is adopted. And also in the case of consumption of water, we are not using the water from the well as such. We have to use then electric ultraviolet water filter to separate the unwanted soluble material from the water. So that is the uses of these filters in our daily life. There are mainly three important uses. Okay. So in today's class, we have discussed about what is sieving, and sieving is done with the help of a sieve, and what how the separation of insoluble solids from liquids can be done. The first techniques are sedimentation and decantation, and also the second method is filtration. Is that clear? So the rest of the portion will be taken in our next class. Thank you.